This is Peter Helen with Citizens for Community Media. There's an interesting report out even just this morning that Mayor Pete Buttigieg is wanting to pursue the Democratic chairman position on the national level, and that he's in the running. And I was with a bunch of men this morning. We were discussing that. And this is a good place to start because this is Mike Jones, of course, and we were looking at a tape he did, an interview with a Notre Dame professor back in May on his philosophical view regarding his position, political position.
Right.
And so we're seeing some of these things come together that make an interesting story.
Yeah, just as we're getting a bead on his philosophy, suddenly he's going to leave. But it's not surprising. It's not surprising. I've said this in numerous programs before, that South Bend is only a stepping stone for the man who's been anointed by the New York Times as going to be the first gay president. So.
But you say that like it's a negative. I think people in town think that's great that he's.
That he's using us as a stepping stone in his career?
No, I don't think they don't.
I think that's good.
They don't necessarily see it that way, that we had the privilege of having him as mayor, and now he's, you know, I mean, you can view it that
way,
too.
How are you, privilege or what, or being stepped on? Either way, it looks as if he's moving on, everybody knew this. I mean, everybody I talked to knew this. He's got no future in Indiana. He's got no future in electoral politics, basically, in Indiana.
Well, Trump won Indiana about 62% to Hillary's 36%, and obviously Mayor Pete was on Hillary's side.
Right. This was completely predictable, okay? But what isn't completely predictable is the turn that the whole political situation has taken as of the election. The election was a resounding, at least in terms of the Electoral College, a resounding victory for Donald Trump. And now what we saw, if you'll remember, during that election, there was a moment of colossal scandal when during one of the debates, the moderator asked Trump if he would accept the results of the election, and he said, well, I'll have to see what happens. Well, they were scandalized. The New York Times was scandalized. All the organs of the oligarchy were scandalized by this thing.
Well, you know they weren't scandalized because they came out and joined Hillary.
What happened, of course, is that the very thing that they were scandalized about is now being put into practice.
The very thing they decided they liked.
From the moment... the day after the election, we've seen nothing but one attempt after another to overthrow the election. The first attempt was the George Soros funding of Black Lives Matter street demonstrations that took place. This is an exact replication of the plan that was put into effect in Iran in 2009. All the way down to the color. Different color, but same plan. In other words, the similarities between the elections were uncanny. First of all of the oligarchs, the elites in Iran, were in favor of Ahmadinejad's opponent. Ahmadinejad was the incumbent. He was considered a man of the people. He had grown up through the political system, became mayor of Tehran, instituted a love campaign or something like that, where he'd help pay dowries for women, young poor women, so they could get married and so on and so forth. A man of the people, and the oligarchs didn't like him. The oligarchs spent so much time during this election talking to each other that they convinced themselves that he couldn't possibly win. Well, then he won.
Right, but I'm not convinced that that's necessarily true. I mean, that's what we believe.
That he won?
That they were surprised. How do we know that that some of them that might have significant control were not surprised? In fact, it was orchestrated to happen this way. I mean, isn't that possible?
It's possible. Whatever it was, there were immediately afterwards, there were huge street demonstrations in Tehran. And it was called the Green Revolution.
Oh, you're talking about that? Oh, the Iran.
Tehran. Okay, I'm still talking about Iran, okay? So that it happened. The NGOs were already on the ground, ready for the eventuality. They had huge street demonstrations. Now, if the street demonstrations in the United States after the Trump election had gotten big enough, let's say as big as they had gotten in Iran, then phase two would have kicked in. And phase two is where the organizers of the street demonstrations shoot their own people. That's what happened in the Ukraine. It's part of the playbook now. Once the demonstration gets big enough, the demonstration organizers shoot their own people, and then they say the government did it, and the government has lost legitimacy because it's killing its own people, and we need regime change.
Now I had you confused, because I was thinking the Trump election. No, they knew.
I'm saying that back to the United States, it never reached that status in the United States. There were small demonstrations. It fizzled within days.
Yeah, because like one guy said, with Trump winning, and he said, now the adults are back in charge.
Yeah. Which is precisely what happened in Iran. The adult, namely the ultimate adult, the supreme leader, came in, certified the election, and said, no, he won the election fair and square. It's over. And that was the end of the demonstration. But people died. A woman died. She got shot. Nobody knows who shot her, but I suspect it was the people who organized the demonstration who shot her. So anyway, it never got that far. So then we go to phase two. Jill Stein is going to contest, demand a recount. This is the second challenge, okay, to the election. The oligarchs are not going to go peaceably here. They're not going to walk quietly into the night here. That doesn't get anywhere.
Sure, but doesn't it seem like controlled opposition? Because it didn't seem like it could ever go anywhere.
Well, we didn't know that. I mean, it looks the intention was pretty clear.
Okay.
The intention was clear. She suddenly showed up with $7 million in her coffers. Where did that come from?
But when it hit Wisconsin, the judges looked at this and they go, what is this?
The judges shot it down in Wisconsin. And apparently the only place where they did the recount, Trump ended up getting more votes than the last one. So now we're in the third phase, and now it's the Russia. Russia stole the election. Russia hacked into the Democratic committee's computers, the very computers that Pete is now going to take over. They were hacked by the Russians, and now we're going to a huge campaign to influence the Electoral College to reject the popular results. The same thing, same type of story over and over and over again here. It's the oligarchs refusing to accept the democratic process. They have become so drunk with their own power that they think that they own the democratic process. And so they make all the lip service like Hillary will concede, but apparently she's behind this now attempt called the Hamilton electors or something like that to convince these people not to vote for the people, not to vote for the candidate that the people in their state chose
for
some type of higher moral reason. So the higher moral reason, that brings us back to our own philosopher king,
right?
Namely Pete Buttigieg. Now, who knew?
Because they're all drawing on that, some of it, the Rhodes Scholar.
Well, wait, yeah. Who knew that this man was the great philosopher king? It turns out that a professor at Notre Dame invited him over, Professor Megan Sullivan in the philosophy department, and she asked him some questions, and it turns out that he reads Kant, Immanuel Kant.
Right, and this was a 25-minute interview by her.
Yeah.
They were fellow cohorts in the Rhodes Scholar,
right,
in Oxford.
Yeah.
2005, they were together. And there's like 200 views on YouTube on this, that you can see it on YouTube.
Yeah.
So it didn't
take off. It's not viral. We wouldn't call this viral yet.
No, but 200 people saw it, and maybe the class participated.
Okay. So now we have some insight into the mind here of our philosopher king, who may go off now to become the head of the Democratic National Committee. Okay. So. Why Kant? Well, Professor Megan jumps in right away and starts talking about the categorical imperative. She never mentions it, but that's what she's talking about. And basically, it's about morality, because this is the issue here. This is the issue in this election. Let's face it. The issue was that Trump was immoral, according to some type of morality that we're not quite we haven't been clued. There's a higher morality at work here, and according to those principles, this guy is a bad person.
No,
and then the people, in a sense, chose him in spite of it, so the people are therefore immoral, and the people, because they are immoral, they have no rights, and so therefore we can invalidate the election. I think that's the logic of what's going on here.
Right, but just to we're on Citizens for Community Media, and while we were waiting to come here in the back room, we're watching another lady give a talk, and it was on Donald Trump. Well, then we talked to her, and she said she grew up with Trump. I mean, so this is good for community media, that we have local people telling us what they feel, and she grew up with him.
Yes.
I don't know the relevance. It's just interesting that...
Yeah, well, it's obviously on everyone's mind. But, I mean, what we're seeing here is we have now some type of insight into the real dynamic of how this is being used for political power. I mean, I just expressed it here. If you watch this interview of the mayor closely, you listen closely, there are two aspects involved here. You know, you're a mayor, you have to go out and listen to the people. Okay, well, that's simple enough. That would be like the election, right? Trump got elected, so that's the end of the story. But no, that's not the end of the story. There's another aspect to this thing, because at a certain point, you have to push the people in a certain direction. That's what he's talking. That's what he says, too. Well, what's the direction that you're pushing them? Well, it's what's right. Well, what he's talking about is morality.
And I totally agree with him. You can't just always go with the people
right. Okay.
say.
So the question is, well, what is this morality? Well, after a while, it becomes pretty clear that the morality of our philosopher king is equality. That's
right.
That's the essence of morality.
So in other words, when he uses the word morality, he'd be actually clearer if he said the word equality.
Yeah, in other words, I have to push for equality. And of course, in his particular circumstance, that means homosexual rights or equality for homosexuals, because that's what he is. Okay, that's his kind of defining characteristic. He's the one who came out. He's the one who told us that. And so the whole project comes down to basically, the whole moral project, the whole South Bend project comes down to basically, well, we'll listen to the people, and if they come up with the right answer, then we'll do what they say. If they don't, well, then we have to trump their popular beliefs with the superior morality, which is basically equality for homosexuals.
Well,
that's the story.
I would tend to agree with him, except if he stayed with the traditional definition of morality, because if the people all said, we think sodomy's all right, then a good leader would have to say, sorry, that goes against the Ten Commandments,
right.
And I can't accept that.
But we have the exact opposite situation.
Right.
Because if you were to ask the majority of the people, they would say sodomy is not okay. As a matter of fact, the state of Indiana passed some laws in this regard to protect the consciences of people who felt they couldn't go along with it, and then he's upset that those laws, okay? Okay, so basically he had to impose this on the people. Okay, so here you see this kind of interaction between democracy and oligarchy. Now, the chairman of the local Democratic Committee was quoted in an article in Politico today.
Was that the one that said that you they didn't really want you in town or anybody that hung with you?
That was this guy, when we held the press conference in front of the black church out on the west
Fillmore,
side of town.
Yeah.
He made a statement that I was a racist. Okay, here I am surrounded by black ministers, but somehow I'm a racist. Okay, so that was his claim to fame at that point. But now he's back in the news, and he says, Pete is just the guy that the Democratic Party needs because he's got total support in the community. He's got blue-collar people supporting him. I thought, wait a minute, what election are we talking about here? The election after he announced that he was a homosexual got 11% of the registered voters to vote.
Right, but he won 80%.
He won 80% of 11%, which brings us down to like 7%. Okay, now 7% is not a big number. In terms of elections, if you held an election in Bosnia under UN auspices, it would be disqualified
right, so
because of the low turnout. So there is no broad-based consensus or support or anything else here. It is completely a situation where the oligarchs have imposed their views on a demoralized population. The voters of St. Joe County, completely demoralized at this point, and who suddenly they became energized when they felt that they had a candidate who supported their interests, namely Trump, in this election. And now the oligarchs are using this minuscule participation in the election as some type of mandate to impose some type of superior morality on the rest of us. I mean, this is why this discussion is interesting, because you have the collaboration here of Notre Dame University and the local Democratic Party. Notre Dame, ever since Hesburgh's era, has been an adjunct of the Democratic Party. It was a standing joke when Hesburgh was alive. John Bradamus would have meetings, you know, of the Democratic Party, and there would Hesburgh would be there, and he announced to the crowd, you know, well, we all know the Father Hesburgh doesn't endorse any candidates, and everybody would roar with laughter at that point. It was a standing joke. Nothing has changed except the tenacity with which the faculty at Notre Dame are holding on to this failed ideology of political correctness. They are the commissars that get to impose this political correctness on the people, on the students of the University of Notre Dame, largely Catholic.
Do you think they hold to that because of peer pressure, or they hold to it because they personally, individually believe in it?
The faculty?
Yeah.
The faculty have committed themselves to the comfortable life of academia. So
it's peer pressure?
No, it's not. It's not peer pressure. It's their own desires for a comfortable life. Obviously, they're all in the same. They all have the same desires.
Okay.
You know, in other words, if it comes to a choice between telling the truth or continuing to lead my comfortable life, I will choose to lead my comfortable life. That's my career. That's what I dedicate my life. My life is my career.
Well, yeah, you get married, you have a wife, and you have three kids, and you want them to be successful, and they have to pay $70,000 a year to go to their choice university.
You're committed to a system, and you're committed to your role in the system. And the problem here is that it's a complete distortion, ends up with a complete distortion of what you're there to do, which is to say, teach philosophy.
Critical thinking, truth.
Okay, well, let's just even narrow it down to something really specific. Like, what did Immanuel Kant have to say about morality? Now, Kant is the idea, he had a critique der reinen Vernunft, the critique of pure reason. Critique der praktischen Vernunft, the critique of practical reason. Kant was an Enlightenment philosopher, okay, but he had the sense all the way from the ancients that there were two branches of knowledge. The one is pure reason, which seeks the truth, and the other is practical reason, which seeks the good. And how do we achieve the good?
Well, the show was called God and the Good Life.
Right.
So that's similar.
How do you understand? How do you know what the good is? And secondly, how do you achieve it? This is why we have practical reason. Well, that's what Immanuel Kant. That's right. So Kant is also an Enlightenment philosopher. Okay, which means he's trying to come up with a version of morality that is independent of religion, because morality is always associated with religion. It's always been associated with religion. Religion has been discredited in Germany because of the Reformation. It's that simple. So you have two competing groups who call themselves Christian, and they can't agree, and so therefore we have to go to another source, and that means now just reason alone.
Well, she said that. She said when you have if you were debating a really morally serious policy, well, you can't bring religious ideas in to solve that.
Right. So that's like the classic Enlightenment solution to the religious warfare problem. Of course, it has problem of its own. Okay.
Well, you might be throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
You may very well have thrown the baby out with the bathwater. And the main problem was that you cannot maintain morality without religion. Okay, that was what the founding fathers worried about. John Adams worried about it. George Washington worried about it, and their fears have proven to be true.
Well, the Constitution, I studied this movement to amend the Constitution, which is a strong movement. You had Supreme Court justices, governors, all, to put God back in. I think the Confederacy saw that problem. The first thing they did was create the same Constitution, basically, but put God into the Constitution. Because without a reference point in the supreme law of the land, who determines that reference point can move anywhere it wants? I mean, specifically, they wanted to put Jesus Christ in. They didn't. They failed. God gives you something, but when you bring in Jesus, it really clarifies the definition of morality.
Yes.
But right now, it's total confusion.
So this could have... This is a document that could have worked out, I guess, given the proper cultural support. But there was an element, a kind of revolutionary element in the United States that just would not allow this to happen.
No, you can never get a movement to get an amendment to the Constitution that would recognize God.
Right. So we're far gone now. We're far along. So back to Kant, back to the Enlightenment. Is it possible to come up with a notion of morality without a religious backing? I would say yes. I think the answer is yes. Because Kant was right. Morality is practical reason. And practical reason is innate to the human being. It's logos. If you are a rational creature, that means you have the ability to understand how to act. Now, Aquinas dealt with this in his own way in the Middle Ages by saying, look, yes, it's true. You can deduce all of these principles of morality from the first principles of practical reason, but most people are not philosophers. And so God understood that, and so he gave the law from God. So let's say Moses. Moses goes up to top of Mount Sinai. He's given the Ten Commandments. This is directly from God. It's all from God anyway. Even from a natural perspective, it has to come from God.
Here is a scripture we were going to start out with that one of our friends said, why don't you read out of the Jerusalem Bible. It says, Romans 1, 21, the more they called themselves philosophers, the more stupid they grew, until they exchange the glory of the immortal God. But it's saying what you're saying, and then it goes on and says that, but God has revealed to just natural man his moral law inside their heart.
That's right. That's so, right.
But the ones that claimed to be the smartest are the ones that lost it.
That's right. And so we have a classic example of this right here in this interview between Professor Megan Sullivan and Mayor Pete Buttigieg. They start off, for some strange reason, wanting to talk about morality. Okay, and Professor Megan says, Kant says that it has to be your actions have to be universalizable in order for them to be considered moral. This is what Kant called the categorical imperative. They never mentioned it, but that's what it's called. Okay, well, what's the elephant in the room here? The elephant in the room is that you're talking to a mayor, the gay mayor. And not only the gay mayor, but the mayor who has announced publicly that he is a homosexual and also that he's interested in following morality.
But he's not even married, and he supposedly he's living with a guy.
So what?
Isn't that a problem?
So you've got this issue of homosexuality. Well, let's take it just on the premises that they have established. Is homosexuality universalizable? Or let's put it this way. If everyone acted like a homosexual, what would the outcome be? Well, it would be the end of the human race. Okay? Now, is that a good thing? No, that's not a good thing. So therefore,
that's the test.
That's the test. You flunked the test, Pete.
She's the one that came up with it. She said,
you flunked your own test. We're not talking about some type of Bible thumper who's telling you that you're going to hell because you're a sodomite. You flunked your own test. Well, and the whole point here is you flunked your test. She's the one who brought it up, and yet she can't seem to connect the dots here.
Well, it's like in those game shows, what subject do you want? Well, he said, of all the philosophers, I like Kant.
And then he likes to talk about morality too.
Yeah, he laid out.
Well, this is what Kant said about morality. So, as if that's not damning enough, Kant wrote a book called The Metaphysics of Morals, in which he explicitly condemns homosexuality.
I read that on the
and says that it's worse than suicide. Comparing it with suicide in the same way that we just mentioned, because in a sense, homosexuality is a kind of suicide. If everyone acted according to this principle, it would be the suicide of the human race.
Right, he put homosexuality, bestiality, masturbation, and then this article put in bastard children. And Kant
So obviously, we're not even getting Kant here. You brought it up. And then the whole discussion revolves around a completely censored, Baudelaireized version of Kant that has no reality to the real German philosopher. And this is known as education. At this point, you begin to see the magnitude of this oligarchic corruption of our culture. Because basically, Notre Dame, after Hesburgh stole Notre Dame from the Catholic Church, it became a state institution. The state pours money into Notre Dame to do what? Not to teach what Immanuel Kant taught, evidently, because you'll never find that out. Because as soon as it gets into some area where it's getting too close to violating one of the tenets of political correctness, we don't talk about it.
Well, I think she got in there. She was apparently the same age as Mayor Pete, and they were together in the Rhodes Scholar.
Well, let's talk about that for a moment. Why, this is obviously the link that they have. It's basically the Rhodes Scholarship.
They were together in 2005.
Yes, they're both core, which means it's your golden ticket to academe if you're a Rhodes Scholar. But what is a Rhodes Scholar? It's someone who is benefiting from the largesse, the financial largesse of Cecil Rhodes, who was the empire builder in Africa. In other words, the subjugation of the black races is what Cecil Rhodes was involved in, and the promotion of the Anglo-American Empire for the further subjugation of black races in perpetuity. Now, this is the operation here that gives these people some type of legitimacy to then impose the exact opposite type of racial discrimination on the society at large.
I mean that'd be like the Hitler.
We don't want to talk about it. Even though apparently at Oxford there was a movement to remove Cecil Rhodes' statue.
I remember that.
From the public arena.
Because of how he...
Okay, so what are we talking about? We're talking about pure and simple social engineering. The involvement of the government in higher education, ratified by Lemon versus Kurtzman. The other decision, Tillman. Anyway, I forget the name of it. But anyway, the entry of government funding into higher education.
Well, didn't it really increase? My dad was Navy, you know, Navy in Notre Dame. You know, he'd always go down, even when I'm 6 years old, he'd go down there. And he used to always tell us that Notre Dame produced the fourth number of officers next to the Army, Navy, and,
yes, I'm talking about something later now, though. The flood of government money turned what were educational institutions into indoctrination camps.
Didn't that happen after the World War II a lot?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, it did.
It
was an effect of the war, but it turned them into very expensive indoctrination camps, which is what they are today, where you learn the word Immanuel Kant. You will not hear the word. You will learn sort of some of what he said, but you will never be able to connect the dots and understand the full implications of what he said, because that will be suppressed, because it contradicts the political correctness that is the regime at every institution, which is basically not based on Kant. It's based on Michel Foucault.
Right, and we'll get to that. But I'm thinking, at that age, Plato said no one shouldn't be allowed to be a philosopher unless he's 50 or something like that. These kids are 18, 19, 20, and they're being told, oh, you're so smart, and look at what you're reading, and you're so smart, and then they have to act like they understand it. And then they go out like they did understand it, and they get positions of prominence. Yeah, but what do they understand?
You're seeing it right before our eyes. So this is the oligarchic institution. Okay, here are two of the prime candidates who have been anointed. Well, obviously one more prime than the other, have been anointed by the oligarchs to be our future leaders because they will steer the culture in the directions which the oligarchs favor. But that's why they're there.
If you force a definition out, like say a morality, out of Megan or Mayor Pete, what kind of definition would they give for morality?
You have to deduce that, I think, from the course of the discussion, because they're not going to say it. I mean, morality is practical reason. Kant has used the term practical reason. That's true. It is practical reason. But what they're doing is completely a complete violation of the basic principles that they're invoking.
Because practical reason would line up with the Ten Commandments.
Of course it does.
Right, but theirs doesn't.
No, because theirs is social engineering. So what is their morality? So you can deduce this from the way the discussion went. Okay, which is basically the mayor talking about what it's like to be mayor of South Bend, Indiana. And so it's sort of like, well, you have to go out and talk to the people. Well, that's fine up to a certain point, but then suddenly you have to move the people in a certain direction. Well, suddenly now you're talking about some type of higher criterion, okay? So you're talking about some type of morality. Well, what is that direction? Suppose you went to the people of South Bend, Indiana the first time around and announced that you were homosexual.
First
time around.
Well, you were on record for saying that he wouldn't have gotten elected.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think he would have gotten elected.
Probably not. It was too big of a shock.
Okay. So let's put it this way. Suppose you went to the people of South Bend and you said, do you think that homosexual behavior is acceptable, morally acceptable? I think that the majority of the people of South Bend would say no. I think the majority of the people of Indiana...
The majority
of the people of Indiana would say no. The majority of the people of the United States would say no. I think that this is clear. All of these initiatives have to be imposed by oligarchic institutions. So if you take abortion was never approved by the people of the United States. It was imposed by the Supreme Court, and the same thing happened with homosexual marriage a year ago with the Obergefell decision.
But you're assuming that the people do have this common sense, but if they were watching 4 hours of TV
I'm saying even given the massive social engineering...
They still were surviving.
Even given the massive social engineering that the United States people have been subjected to ever since World War II, they still have this residual morality that would make them say, no, I think it's wrong. So what do you do then? Well, at this point, the other part of Pete's program kicks in, and that means you got to do what's right. Well, what do you mean what's right? What is right? Well, it's obvious that there's one word answer to this question, and that's equality.
Right.
Equality. We have to impose... This was the program of the left wing of the French Revolution. Remember the French Revolution? Liberty, fraternity, equality.
Yeah.
Okay, we don't hear much about fraternities anymore unless you're in Bloomington. But we have liberty and we have equality. Well, they contradict each other. Okay,
yeah.
You can't have both. Liberty now becomes the party of the capitalist. Equality becomes the party of the socialist. And what we have now is this mystical convergence that took place recently, where the CEOs fly in and they impose the homosexual agenda. So it's CEOs imposing socialism on the rest of us. Equality, this type of thing.
But the reason it's equality, of course, if you remember Mark Knoll, and I probably said it a dozen times on the show throughout the years, Mark Knoll, front headlines of the paper in the column, that theology today has been mostly determined by the canons of Sherman and Grant. Lincoln gave the Gettysburg Address and said that we are a people that are dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. And that was
It's in the Declaration of Independence. And it's also contradicted by the Constitution of the United States. So you have this incoherence at the...
He had to straighten it out. That war was...
There was
incoherence. Straighten it out.
That's right. And there was incoherence in the French Revolution. They had a civil war right after they had their revolution as well. Okay? So this is... We're back to the moral situation here, which is basically what I've been trying to say all along, that the country is created, or recently, up to this point, has been a situation where the purpose is to get the overwhelming majority of the populace to ratify the program of the oligarchs. As long as that happens, everyone's happy, everything comes along, except for the fact that the oligarchs are in the business of grinding people into dust because their main engine of control is usury. And so basically everyone suffers economic decline. And what we saw in this last election was the economic decline had reached a point where there were so many people hurting that they decided to do something, and that's why Trump got elected. Certainly in Indiana, I was there looking at the people. They were hurting economically.
Yeah, more than you can think, because it was a type of hurt that you don't know how to express.
That's right. That's right. So here we are, the situation, and now we have the situation. Well, how are the oligarchs going to reassert their power? Well, they're now in the middle of trying to overturn the election. Once again, we're now to the third attempt to overturn this election. And the guy is still hasn't made it to the White House yet.
Well,
he
still hasn't been inaugurated. The idea is that Obama was in for 8 years, and now he's been able to put the CIA now has formed around the Obama administration, so they favored them, right? Or what is?
No, I think that what you saw during this election was a civil war in groups like the CIA and the FBI. I think there were large segments of those groups who were completely unhappy with the prospect of Hillary Clinton and the way the country was going.
Yeah, but it's a group that fought that's now trying to take down Trump. So this is coming from...
Just that group presupposes there's another group. Now, there may not be a group. It may just come down to one guy.
Well, you mentioned that one guy.
Yeah, the guy who's basically was in the CIA. Now he's working for one of the Clinton's fundraisers. He's the one who's created this so-called meme that the Russians have interfered in our election. There's no proof whatsoever for this. No proof whatsoever.
Well, what's it mean to interfere? I mean, governments, we're trying to hack everybody we can. We know
we overturn any government in the world, and we feel that that's our sovereign right to do that.
Right. So they find...
We tried to overthrow the election in Iran in 2009, but that's okay. But now they're claiming with no proof whatsoever.
Well, we did it for the right reason.
That's right. And so here we are. We're back to this superior morality. These people are convinced, and you can tell Pete is convinced that he has access to this superior morality.
But the superior morality and the superior force of arms seem to kind of always go together.
Yeah, they do seem to go together. So basically, the superior morality is might makes right. And Professor Megan is just thrilled to death that she has the opportunity to inculcate this spirit, the superior morality of the Rhodes Empire.
Into her students?
Cecil Rhodes, the empire builder, the railroad built on the backs of black slaves.
That they killed, right? I mean, they just worked them to death?
Every tie, another black worker. For the glory of the Anglo-American Empire. And she gets to impose, she has the privilege to impose this superior morality on the benighted students, Catholic students at Notre Dame University. That's the situation we have reached. The situation was intolerable. That's why we had this big change in the election, and the fact of the matter is that the oligarchs are still not ready to accept the fact that their program has been rejected by the people of the United States of America. Notre Dame is in denial. They even had a prayer service for all the poor people who were traumatized by the fact that Hillary Clinton did not get elected.
But where you taught St. Mary's, it was even worse?
It was worse at St. Mary's. Worse at St. Mary's. I don't know whether they handed out puppies at St. Mary's, but some of the places were handing out puppies because all of the institutions of higher education are re-education indoctrination camps where you get to spend $60,000 a year, go into debt for $60,000 a year to become indoctrinated in the tenets of political correctness. Everyone found that intolerable, except the professors themselves, whose livelihood is now, at least the credibility, the intellectual foundation of what they're doing has now been threatened.
Yeah,
because if this interview between Pete and Professor Megan proves anything, it is that it's completely bogus. You're not talking about Kant. You don't have a clue about what Kant is really talking about. You're not talking about practical reason. You're not talking about the categorical imperative. You're talking about this politically correct version to keep your students in the dark.
Well, how about if Mayor Pete talks about Jesus or the Christian faith? Is he talking about the correct Jesus? He says he's a Christian.
Peter, we're trying to play by their rules. They are the ones who established the rules. I'm saying even according to their own rules, they're not being honest.
No, because Kant is the philosopher of his choice.
He's the one who brought up Kant. He's the one who announced he's a homosexual. Well, Kant had very specific things to say about homosexuality, and they don't agree with what Pete says.
Just the opposite.
It's the opposite of what he says. So why? What is this? You don't give us this. I don't believe it. I'm sorry. Because that's not the game plan that you're working according to anyway. The game plan, as I've said before, is Michel Foucault, the homosexual whose philosophy is the operating system of every university in this country. And he got that from his father, Joe Buttigieg, the professor at Notre Dame, who mainstreamed Foucault into the Catholic university up there.
But usually
in the 80s.
Usually you can track it down. Is there, before Foucault, who was it before Foucault? And
Foucault
then,
was...
How did it go from Kant, the Enlightenment? How did it go from the Enlightenment to Foucault?
Okay, the Enlightenment ended with the death of Hegel in 1831. At this point, there was a materialist reaction against one of the greatest periods in the history of philosophy. I'm talking about from Kant to Hegel. Kant, Fichte, Schelling, Hegel. Great moment in philosophy. It was the resurrection of Logos in European thought after the Babylonian captivity at the hands of David Hume and the British empiricists. Logos had been reborn, and then it died with Hegel.
But these were Lutherans, basically, right?
Kant was they were all Protestants, Prussians.
And more Lutheran.
Prussians.
Yeah.
Okay, Prussian and Protestant were the same thing. It died with Hegel, and the proof of it was that one of Hegel's main followers was Karl Marx,
right,
who believed in dialectical materialism. This is preposterous. Anyone who understands what Hegel said about the dialectic knows that it's completely incompatible with matter. We're talking about Geist.
Right. He was
spirit.
All about the soul and the Geist, and then Marx takes...
Vernunft. And it has nothing to do with matter. You can't have dialectical materialism. So philosophy took a nosedive at that point. At that point, we have a period of crisis, and then you have someone like Nietzsche, the rise of someone like Nietzsche, who is a complete irrationalist, who hated Logos, who hated Socrates, hated Socrates, hated reason.
It felt it impinged on his manhood, but he was a joke.
And so with Nietzsche, we have, in other words, what we have is the eclipse of Logos and its replacement with will. In many ways, the same thing that happened to Islamic philosophy 1,000 years ago. Okay, and so we now have philosophies of will. You're going to impose your will, and that is will be what is right and what is wrong. That's basically Nietzsche's morality. And this became the dominant strain, skipped over to the French, and then finally it was picked up by Michel Foucault through an obscure guy by the name of Bataille. But anyway, it was...
But there is a projection that can be intellectually
traced. Foucault is a disciple of Nietzsche. All of the deconstructors, Jacques Derrida, all of the leading lights of that final gasp of French philosophy, they were all disciples of Nietzsche, which is anti-Logos, which is a direct repudiation of what Hegel was all about.
Yeah. My freshman year, I mean, you know, Nietzsche, I mean, I had taken philosophy, and boom, there was Nietzsche. And when you're 19, you're going to go for it.
So if Pete were honest with us, it's just like whenever you're in this guy's presence, he's constantly padding his resume. It's like everything he says is somehow some type of entry on his resume, including this ridiculous notion that somehow Kant has had some type of influence on his life. It's preposterous. I'm sorry. It's Nietzsche. It's Foucault. It's your father. These are the people who have had the influence on your life. Don't give us this. Don't try and throw us off the track with this Kant. And then have this whole professor here who's too stupid to even bring up the most obvious contradiction. All she can say is, that's fantastic. How many times did she say, that's fantastic? Well, instead of saying, well, wait a minute, Pete, if you're talking about the categorical imperative, how does homosexuality, how does that correspond to the categorical imperative? If everyone were a homosexual, the human race would die out. That's the obvious response.
No. The scripture says they teach things which they ought not to for filthy lucre's sake. The money is on the homosexual card. That's where the money is.
Let's get it back to the big picture. The oligarchs have chosen the homosexual as the avant-garde of their revolution and their revolutionary form of control.
Yeah, they put the money there, and everybody knows it.
And the essence of it is this kind of superior morality. They have this superior morality, and you are in error, and error has no rights. That was the message of Brian Benioff of Salesforce when he parachuted into Indiana and told the state legislature, you have to overturn your law because I don't like it.
I don't want to divert, but if you were mayor and you were single and you decided to shack up with a girl, and there's the mayor, he's living with this girl, people might go, that's not right. But if you shack up with a guy, oh, no problem. Like what? Somehow they've given a sanction. They give a free pass to.
Well, this goes back to Nietzsche. Nietzsche's basic project was as he said, the Umwertung aller Werte, the transvaluation of all values. So what you're seeing here is moral sanction is never going to go away. There's always going to be people who are going to say, no, that's wrong. Okay. But what we do is completely turn it upside down. So instead of saying, you will now use that idea of moral indignation against the people who object to your program of transvaluing all values. And that is the way they stay in power. But the problem is it didn't work. And what we're seeing here is Pete, you know.
With the Trump.
That's what I'm saying. With the Trump, because the democracy was the fly in the ointment. So now we have a last gasp, one more attempt to overturn the results of this election in the interest of the oligarchs so that they can continue to impose this tyranny of moral relativism, of Nietzscheanism, of will-based ideology on the rest of it so that they can continue to lead their comfortable, dissolute lives.
Now, you were hoping Trump was going to win the election, right?
I thought he was going to win the election.
But you were hoping he was going to.
What do my hopes have to do
I'm saying that within the Trump electorate, people that voted for Trump, there were voices that had a clear message. One was the rejection of the elites, whether it's intellectual elites, whether it's the money elites.
That's what this campaign is.
There was a consciousness of that.
That's right.
Not everyone had the same consciousness or the degree of it, but there were pockets where there was clear consciousness who they saw the enemy was. And that by voting for Trump, they felt they were putting a blow to those forces. Now, that we don't know if that's going to succeed yet, right?
No. It may be completely undone at this point. Because that's the other part of the story is now the appointments that he's making. And this kind of unsettling feeling that everyone who voted for a repudiation of oligarchic rule now has this uneasy feeling.
Yeah, but let's be real. Who is Donald Trump, one person, to just, you know, stop all that? I mean, he could be going, you know, hold it here. What can I reasonably do? Okay, and his model is Lincoln. Lincoln always picked his enemies and put them on the cabinet. So his thinking could be, well, who's best at finances? Well, the head of Goldman Sachs. I mean,
I think we're making it more complicated than it has to be. The main problem with government is regulatory capture. In other words, you appoint the head of the regulatory agency is the very person you want to regulate. And that what you give is the fiction that, well, the only people qualified to be in the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, are the employees of Monsanto or Big Pharma. And so what you get is the fox invariably gets appointed to be head of the guardian of the hen house.
Well, that
same thing now with Goldman Sachs. Wait a minute, can't we come up with someone other than somebody from Goldman Sachs? Now, maybe a guy who worked for Goldman Sachs 14 years ago, maybe he got on the inside and realized, I'm going to destroy these people. I know the inside workings. I'm going to work from the inside to destroy them now. That's possible, but it may be. I mean, if we want to talk from recent experience, let's go back to Hank Paulson and Tim Geithner. And what did they do? They represented the interest of Goldman Sachs. They didn't represent the interest of the American people, and they were engaged in one of the biggest swindles, certainly in monetary value, in the history of the United States. So are we supposed to learn anything from that? And this is the unsettling feeling that the people who saw Trump as the repudiation of the oligarch are now feeling, I think. In addition to the Goldman Sachs problem, we now have the military problem. Okay, I mean, first of all, let's be honest. If the guy's nickname is Mad Dog, this is probably a reason you don't want to appoint him head of some agency. Probably not a good idea.
No, because he doesn't think reasonably.
I mean, a Mad Dog is not a good sign. Okay, and he was involved in Fallujah, and he's made all kinds of outrageous statements about killing people. That seemed to me would automatically, he is disqualified. First of all, because he's been in the military, in active military, too close to when the appointment will be. So there'll have to be an exception. But this is the type of thing that really causes you to feel uneasy. I mean, maybe Trump is a legend in his own mind. Maybe when he gets in a room with people, it's a room full of dirty Harrys. Well, you know,
like
characters from an Ayn Rand novel. Maybe it's like a whole room full of Ayn Rand characters.
But we learned from Mike Pence that he was supposed to be a strong Christian and he supported the RFRA. But then when the CEOs didn't like it and it came against their interest, Pence capitulated.
He was completely incapable of formulating the issue. He should have simply said, I'm the governor of Indiana. This guy's from San Francisco. Who is he to tell us what to do? He couldn't do it. He was incapable of doing it. He's intellectually crippled.
But that means possibly that all Americans are intellectually crippled.
There's a large amount of it. The big thing to explain is not why Americans are intellectually crippled. The big thing to explain is why they woke up and voted for someone else. That's the big issue. But so the question here is, this brings us to the next big question, which is Zionism. How does this fit into the picture? Pence is a Christian Zionist. We got all these Christian Zionists out there.
No, he's totally on the ads and on the TV.
He's already
supporting Israel
100%. I understand that. Okay, now this is a complete contradiction of the whole program of America First.
I know it.
Okay, America First is let's retrench. Let's deal with America First. Let's have our own foreign policy. Let's not be proxies for Israel's foreign policy, which is what we've been doing in the Middle East for the past years?
Half the Trump supporters, their America First definition was not Israel. Get them out. No longer Israel.
No foreign entanglements. This goes way back to the founding fathers who warned George Washington, you name it. They warned about going abroad to find dragons to slay abroad.
But the other half of Trump supporters did not have a strong consciousness of keep Israel out.
So you're in a situation where there's this incoherence now that's starting to manifest itself. At the same time, there's this ferocious attack on the very wavering kind of incoherent reaction that we did get. So who knows?
And how dangerous is it to have this radical Zionism dominate our foreign policy and influence our internal?
Of course it's dangerous because it could. Who are the people behind the reason? Look, the whole problem with Russia, okay, the most immediate source of that was Victoria Nuland, the Jewish lady who's married to Robert Kagan, the neocon from the Bush era. We voted for Obama as a repudiation of Bush, and now we got the same problem because they're sneaking in the back door, okay? The problem here is, can the United States wage or pursue its own interest without pursuing the interest of taking a backseat to pursuing Israel's interest in the Middle East.
Well, Obama supposedly was going to change Bush. He didn't. He just perpetuated it. Now Trump is supposedly going to change Obama.
Now we've got the same problem.
Will we see the change? Because the most significant change should be what?
Retrenchment, revitalization of the American industrial infrastructure, all of the things that resonated when Trump came to Indiana.
Okay, we got 3 minutes. This is Citizens for Community Media, and of course we emphasize that Trump's whole election was a renunciation. When he came here and spoke, what did he say all the time? You know, they're the enemy. The corporate media is the enemy. He's looking right at him. So local media is obviously important. More and more people see that it is. Where are you at with...
Well, I mean, the election was, among other things, a repudiation of the mainstream media. So the alternative media triumphed over the mainstream. It was David killing Goliath. Right. Here we are. We are the alternative media. And we are the ones that sort of determined the day.
Yeah, we played a... I mean, obviously, this type of media played a role.
The meek inherited the earth.
Yeah, usually you think maybe you got to be crucified.
Usually the meek contest the will. That's about all they can do. But they inherited the earth.
Right, so things are still optimistic.
We'll see. We're in the middle of a huge struggle. And the main thing we have to do is raise the consciousness of people to the terms of this struggle, because the whole democratic process is now being called into question. And that could precipitate a civil war. This when you invalidate an election like this, you're asking for civil war.
Well, people think there's going to be a civil war regardless.
No, I don't. I'm not talking about people. I'm talking, this is serious. If you invalidate election, that's the classic formula for a civil war.
I just can't even imagine that they could do that.
Time will tell.
It's too shocking. Okay, we have 1 minute left. Citizens for Community Media. This is Dr. E. Michael Jones. He's been living here in South Bend since 1979. He qualifies as a local. And I've been here since I graduated from Notre Dame back in the 70s. I'm a local. And we do believe in the Catholic concept of
subsidiarity.
Subsidiarity, which is a good principle. You don't need to have outsiders coming in and telling you how to think. You know, we're capable and made in the God's image. We're capable of reading the scripture, reading the church tradition, and saying, here's what the truth is. So hopefully this is an encouragement for citizens to call down here at WNIT and get your show. Till next time, Peter Hallen and Dr. Jones.